Hi guys, my name is Dr. Zainab Bora, your mentor on the Unacademy platform. I'm bringing to you the second episode of our series, which is focusing on image-based questions. So through this series, my aim is to introduce you and acquaint you with various images which are important, and in the process, orient you with various clinical vignette type of questions that are now being asked very, very frequently in your entrances. So let's have a look at this. Any of you have missed out on the first episode, please look at it. Find it on the Unacademy YouTube page and have a look at it, where we have looked at a very important question from neuroradiology. So those of you who are new to this platform, guys, Unacademy is an online learning platform where you get to attend live classes. So their USP is basically the live classes that you get to have with all the educators across different subjects, which will help you build very, very strong foundations and strong concepts. And you get to, ask all your doubts in real time and get them solved. So please have a look at it. Those of you who have not had a chance to look at it preparing for PG entrances, guys, please, there are a lot of free classes which are available. Just download the app on your phone or check out their website, where you get to see a lot of free classes from all the educators, including myself. If you are interested, if you like what you see in the free classes, guys, you can subscribe for plus courses, basically, where you get to have an in-depth coverage of all the different subjects from multiple educators. So in case you're interested in getting the subscription, guys, a variety of time options are available. So according to your preparation timeline, you can choose that package. And if you want to subscribe, guys, use this code, which is ZVORA, which is my code, ZVORA, in order to get a 10% discount. So with this backdrop, let's begin with the question of our day. So there's a 45-year-old male who presents to you with history of trauma to the head. He is now complaining of bleeding from the ear. The HRCT of temporal bone is shown. What is the diagnosis? So here I have an arrow which is going to help you in diagnosing the pathology which is here. I'm just going to give you a few seconds with this image and the options, and please take a guess as to what you think is the correct answer here. Alright guys, so let's look at this image here. First of all, the first learning point, guys, remember, HRCT is what? It's high resolution CT. Again, I have covered all of this in a free series basically on the Unacademy platform, where I have talked about the basic concepts of different imaging modalities. That is a must watch series, guys, for everybody who's preparing for PG entrances, everybody who's in their final year, in order to get oriented to radiology as such. Alright, so remember, HRCT is nothing but a high resolution CT. As the name suggests, it has a higher resolution, and hence we use it for various intricate areas. Right, areas which have very, very tiny anatomy, tiny structures, and needs a higher resolution for imaging. So temporal bone is just that, exactly that area where we need a higher resolution for imaging. Alright, I'll be briefly talking about the anatomy also. But for now, remember, for temporal bone pathologies, if they ask you what is the investigation of choice, which is a very, very important potential question, remember the answer will be high resolution CT. Now, I have taken this one step further, where I have shown you an image of the high resolution CT of the temporal bone, and I'm asking you the pathology. It's actually a very, very simple question. If you just know what a transverse fracture is, what a longitudinal fracture is, or a comminuted fracture is, basically, if you just know, what they look like or what the definition is, it's a very, very easy question, a very, very easy image to solve, actually. All right. So now let's understand this. What I have shown you is an axial section. All right. Axial section at the level of the temporal bone. What you see here, guys, anteriorly is nothing but the squamous part of temporal bone. These are the mastoid air cells. As we know, air appears black on CT, correct? The only two things which have a negative HU on CT, remember, will be air, which appears pitch dark like this, and we have fat, which appears black, but not as black as air, alright? So the HU of air, remember, is minus 1000. This HU of fat is somewhere around minus 10 to minus 100. But again, a repeat question, two things which have a negative HU, remember, air and fat. Alright, so coming back right here, so these are the mastoid air cells. Now, what is the arrow showing us? Arrow is giving us a clue here, right? So arrow is showing this linear discontinuity between the two bones right here. And anytime I see a linear discontinuity in a bone, guys, what does it mean? It means that there is a fracture, right? So normal CT is definitely out. Anyways, we have an arrow which is showing us some pathology. So normal CT anyways is ruled out. Alright, so now I want to characterize this fracture. So how do we do that? So now we looked at the squamous part, we looked at the mastoid part. Remember, this is the medial part. So this is an axial section where this is anterior, this is posterior, this is lateral, and this is medial. Alright, so the medial projection of the temporal bone, guys, is called what? It's called the petrous apex. Alright, it's called the petrous apex. And the definition of temporal bone, remember, is based on the direction along petrous apex. So if I have a fracture line, guys, which passes along the petrous apex, parallel to it, the diagnosis will be a longitudinal fracture. If there is a fracture, guys, which passes perpendicular to the long axis of the temporal bone or long axis of the petrous bone, remember, it's called a transverse fracture. A comminuted fracture anywhere is something where there are multiple fragments of the bone being fractured, which is definitely not the case here. I see a very, very linear kind of fracture. So comminuted again is out. The real question lies between transverse versus longitudinal fracture. Alright, it's going to become very easy. I'm just going to show you some very, very important images. First, we'll discuss the anatomy. Then I'll show you the differences between the two fractures, and then we'll look at the images. Alright, it'll become much, much easier to solve this question after that. Alright, so let's begin with some anatomy orientation. Alright, so temporal bone, remember, is made up of five parts. Alright, so we have the squamous temporal bone, which is the flat part of the bone, the large part of the bone, which is squamous temporal bone. Then I have the mastoid part of the temporal bone, which you see right here, which has the mastoid air cells, as you can see. Then we have the petrous bone, right, just as we saw here. So in the axis section here, you can see, so this medial ridge of bone that you see here is the petrous part of the temporal bone. Then we have the tympanic part, which forms our middle ear. Correct, the intricate anatomy of the middle ear is formed by the tympanic part of the middle ear, not tympanic part of the temporal bone. And then we have the styloid process. Alright, remember, the syndrome where we have an enlarged styloid process is called what? It's called the Eagle syndrome, and sometimes can present with pain or impingement of the glossopharyngeal nerve. Alright, so this was briefly about the anatomy of the temporal bone. Now let's focus on the very, very important topic, which is the distinguishing factors between longitudinal fracture and transverse fracture. This is very, very important. Alright, this is such an important table, and multiple questions can be framed from this particular table. So let's integrate our ENT knowledge with our radiological knowledge. Alright, so remember, just a theoretical fact, that we have the Ulrich classification, which is used to distinguish the two types. So just one additional fact. Now let's look at the differences. So as we discussed, if the fracture line lies parallel to the long axis of the petrous temporal bone, it's called a longitudinal fracture. So if you just remember the image, guys, I have always realized that whenever I see an image, it helps me remember much, much better. If I have just remembered this table, guys, it becomes so much more difficult to recall what I have studied, right? But if you once see this image, guys, you'll never forget it, right? So remember, always try and integrate images with whatever you're studying. Don't just study the theoretical matter, you know. Studying and integrating with images will help a lot with retention, just from my personal experience is what I'm trying to say. Alright, so as you see here, if I see a parallel line, guys, along the petrous temporal bone, now you can imagine it, this is what is called the longitudinal fracture. Alright, so parallel to long axis will be longitudinal. If something is perpendicular, guys, if something is perpendicular, like we just discussed, if it goes, something goes like this, we will call it a transverse fracture. Alright, I hope the basic definition is clear to everybody. Parallel, longitudinal, perpendicular, transverse. Now let's look at the various complications of these fractures, and this is where your questions come from. This is where you have your theoretical questions which come. Alright, so longitudinal fracture, remember, has a higher predisposition to cause ossicular injury, and that is why it predisposes to conductive hearing loss. Alright, so ossicular injury, tympanic membrane rupture, both of them are more predisposed in the longitudinal fracture, and that is why CHL is more commonly associated with longitudinal fracture. whereas the inner ear or the otic capsule is very rarely involved in the longitudinal fracture. So if I was to go back to this image, guys, what happens is, if this line tends to extend here, if it tends to extend through the tympanic part right here, basically we have the ossicles which are oriented in the middle ear and they tend to be disrupted. So if I have an ossicle right here, basically there is higher risk of it being disrupted by a longitudinal fracture, whereas the otic capsule, which lies posteriorly, alright, will be less commonly involved here. Alright, so this was our very, very important difference. Then coming to the transverse fracture. So because the transverse fracture has a higher risk of facial nerve paralysis and injury to the inner ear, guys, it has a higher risk of SNHL. So in contrast to CHL, here we have SNHL, which is much more common, and also the facial nerve paralysis. So just remember, transverse perpendicular involves two nerves, facial nerve also and vestibulocochlear nerve also, resulting in SNHL. Alright, and because of that, the inner ear, again, a given inference, the labyrinth and the cochlear nerve are more commonly involved here. Alright, so now let's look at the radiological imaging of these two. Alright, so just to re-emphasize, guys, what happens in the longitudinal fracture, it's along the long axis of the petrous bone, as you can see right here, and it tends to involve the ossicles here and cause conductive hearing loss. Alright, on the other hand, we have the transverse fractures, which occurs like this, perpendicular to the long axis of the petrous bone. And what do we have in turn? So here, again, see this image, guys, you will never forget it. So what I see here, guys, remember this particular area here, which is located posteriorly and more medially, correct? So this is lateral, this is medial. So the more medial and the posterior aspect is the inner ear. Alright, so briefly to orient you to this HRCT of the temporal bone, guys, remember, anteriorly I have the squamous temporal bone. All of these tiny, tiny cells that you are seeing, guys, air-filled cells, are what? These are the mastoid air cells. These are the mastoid air cells. Remember, when we have mastoiditis, what will happen is, they will all be opacified. The air will be replaced by pus. And in chronic end-stage mastoiditis, what will happen is, it will all become sclerotic. The entire area becomes sclerotic. Alright, so that is how we recognize mastoiditis on imaging. So this is mastoid air cells. What I see here is the middle ear cavity. Alright, so this is the middle ear cavity. You see these ossicles, basically. These structures which you see here, these bony structures that we see right here, are the ossicles, which are more commonly involved in the longitudinal fracture. And the area that I see here, guys, this particular area right here is the inner ear. Alright, so this is the cochlea, and we have the semicircular canals and the vestibule right here. Alright, so because of this area being more frequently involved by our transverse fracture, which is a perpendicular fracture along the long axis, what happens is, there is cochlear disruption which happens. There is injury to the facial nerve, the eighth nerve complex, which will occur. Also remember this medial projection. You see this medial projection? This is nothing but the internal auditory canal. Alright, so this is the internal auditory canal that you see right here. Let me just erase my markers and then it will be much, much clearer to you. So what we see here, this opening, guys, is the internal auditory canal, which leads up to the inner ear. And here, this particular area, guys, this is the area where the facial nerve will course. Alright, so along the posterior wall, the facial nerve will course. Alright, so because of this fracture, basically there is a higher risk of facial nerve injury also, and the because of it reaching the ISE also, there is a higher risk of it causing sensory neural hearing loss. And this structure right here is nothing but the petrous apex, as you all know. So I hope this basic anatomy is clear. The temporal bone anatomy, believe me, is a very, very difficult thing to master. Even radiologists struggle with it. So remember, it's a very intricate area. You won't be tested, but the basic parts you should know. What is lateral? What is medial? What does the mastoid air cell look like? Where is the inner ear? So just the basic anatomy you should be familiar with. Only the things that I have told you so far. So I hope the differences between longitudinal and transverse fracture are much more clearer to you, and you'll be able to remember the important table of differences much, much better now that you have these mental images to support the table with. Alright, now just one extra pointer to you guys. So this classification, guys, of longitudinal and transverse, basically the early classification is an older one, right? Now, basically, because of clinical implications, the classification which was proposed by Brody et al. Is used, which says that just divide the fractures according to whether they are otic capsule sparing or they are disrupting the otic capsule. Basically, whether the inner ear, guys, is involved or not is the major question. Alright, so this is the new classification. Just an extra edge pointer for you so that you are, aware of all the recent trends that are developing, and any extra edge question that is put to you, you can master that. That is my aim in all my classes. Basically, if you've ever seen my class, I keep giving a few extra edge pointers to you so that, you know, those of you who are at the top of your preparation, who've revised everything, who've given the exam once, who've done the revision once, can get that extra booster, you know, so that you can push your rank. In case you get that one or two questions which are not solvable by anybody, if you've seen my classes and if you've seen those extra edge pointers, maybe, you know, that can just clinch you that top rank that you're aiming for. So that is my aim with all my classes. So remember, just as well, Brody classification, the new classification of temporal bone fractures into otic capsule sparing, otic capsule disrupting. So that's it for this short YouTube session, guys. Keep calm and keep enjoying medicine. The more you enjoy your learning, the better and more efficient it will be. So don't take this PG preparation journey as a burden, guys. Enjoy it, enjoy the learning, and keep integrating different things that you learn, and keep making medicine much more interesting, and that'll be very beneficial for you in your PG preparation as well and in life. Ultimately, our goal is to become better doctors, right? So keep preparing with that goal in mind, and PG prep won't be so stressful. Alright guys, thank you so much. I'll see you with the episode 3 of this particular series. I hope you like this series, and please drop your feedback in your comment section or in the live chat if you're looking at the premiere. Thank you guys. Bye-bye.